गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल माय फ्रेंड्स कोंकोना। टुडे वी विल डिस्कस ऑन द आईएनए ट्रेजर आवर द वर्डिक्ट ऑन आवर केस ऑन दिस आईएनए ट्रेजर इन दिस कलकत्ता हाई कोर्ट। एक्चुअली शंकर कुमार चैटर्जी उत्पल कंकना दिस इज ए ओल्ड केस। आई विल रीड आउट द वर्डिक्ट, आई विल डिस्कस ऑन द वर्डिक्ट, बट बिफोर दैट आई विल ट्राई टू टेल यू द बैकग्राउंड ऑफ दिस केस एंड दैट विल बी ऑल्सो इम्पॉर्टेंट टू अंडरस्टैंड दिस केस। And majority of us, our friends, are more interested about only Netaji mystery. But I request them to see this Netaji mystery from different angles. INA treasure is also an important aspect to that. Maybe we will not be able to recover the INA treasure, whatever pilfered by the leaders and some other persons related. But we must discuss this part of history, and that will give us the idea how our national wealth is being pilfered and how the dacoits of our national wealth are the leaders of our partitioned India, truncated India, and how they are in camouflage. The thieves, the dacoits, the shaitans have ruled our country for last 70 years after such a big pilferage. The INA treasure, the tragedy, there are so many big politicians in the opposition and so many historians has written on the INA and many ones on the INA mystery, but very few has discussed on this INA treasure. And sorry to tell you, even Shahnawaz Khan committee, which have been discussed in parliament and also discussed in different ways in different forums, there was a chapter in Shahnawaz Khan committee report in chapter 6, Shahnawaz committee, the official part, there is a big chapter related to INA treasure, and there is adequately written that INA treasure has been looted, and also there was a suggestion that a separate committee should be there by the government of India to see this angle. But sorry to tell you, government of India was always eager to execute his suggestion to bring the assets from Taiwan, from Renkoji, but never picked up the issue of the INA treasure. All intellectuals, all historians, all parliamentarians, either they did not see this chapter or avoided that chapter for this reason or that reason, I do not know. For the first time in 98, Dr. Subramaniam Swamy in parliament and also outside the parliament in 1978, after the emergency, the Janata Raj government picked up this issue in parliament and outside the parliament of this INA treasure loot. In his all speeches, he directed his finger towards Nehru. After that, Morarji Bhai just investigated into the issue, but the chapter was closed thereafter, after some investigation into the materials which is now in the National Museum some jewelry, as if those jewelry was recovered from the crashed air crash field area in Taiwan, collected there, and then kept in Tokyo, then brought to Delhi. And there is a mystery. There is a huge mystery which has been told by the Subramanian Swami. Also the papers which we have recovered from the Justice Mukherjee Commission at that time, when the proceedings was going on, I and Surajit Dasgupta collected those papers in certified copy forms. There we show that the wealth came from Tokyo by an ICS officer, some Dalme, who was the Secretary of the Agriculture, who brought this wealth from Tokyo, and it was in Tinmurti, it was in the personal residence of Nehru for few days. And this did not come to India through official channel, bypassing all official procedures in the airports. This went to the personal residence of Nehru. And after a few days, it went to the National Museum. In Nehru's language, this has been kept in the National Museum as an evidence that this is the materials collected from the crashed area of the airport. And here Subramanian Swami has directly put a question: why this wealth first went to the residence of the Nehru? This is a big question. And before that, I tell you one thing. There are other papers very indicative. From 19, before that, the wealth. You know, Nehru went to Malaysia and Singapore in March 1946. Apparently, it was told the people that he went there to look after the imprisoned INA soldiers. But it was just the outer side. The inside story is, he went there for three specific reasons. One is to share the INA treasure loot. Number two, to be clear that Subhas Bose is really dead or not. And number three, to have a process for transfer of power and partition with a good understanding with the Mountbatten, which is going to the next Viceroy in Delhi. This was the background works of his visit. But those papers are available, some of the papers are available now, which we got, some of the files we got from the JMCI, and some of the files are now declassified from the PMO 2 years back, along with the NHD papers. Here we'll see that Nehru is interested in 1946 about the INA property. And here on record, that in one page, the record is about 6 kg of gold is being transferred to the personal account of Nehru in the Indian Overseas Bank. And be sure that many of the papers are destroyed. But that is the tip of the iceberg. Moreover, some papers has come out. Those papers related to the Tokyo mission, our foreign mission in Tokyo. Remember, first 6 years, we could not place an ambassador in Tokyo because it was totally under the USA military control. At that time, our foreign office in Tokyo was in the status of the foreign office mission, Tokyo mission, not the embassy. The correspondence that time between our Tokyo mission in Tokyo and Delhi foreign office, our foreign ministry office, the correspondence file, some of the files I got about 20 years back. And some of the files now declassified. From those files, it is clear that just after the transfer of power, when Nehru became the prime minister in 47 August, our foreign mission in Tokyo, where Chettur was the 1950-51-52, Chettur was in charge, and Chakraborty ICS was the secretary in Commonwealth office in Delhi, and also secretary in the related to foreign office in Delhi. Their correspondence between Chettur and Chakraborty. This correspondence will clearly show you that, number one, our foreign mission in Tokyo is conscious about the pilferage of the INA property by Ramamurthy brothers. And also very conscious that IR has gone there without following the official formalities, bypassing all official formalities. And on record, they are writing that this IR has come to take the share of the loot, INA wealth loot. This correspondence is clearly, and also there is record that the foreign office wants recovery of the INA wealth from Tokyo banks and whatever in the personal positions of these Ramamurthys. But on record it is written that Prime Minister do not want an investigation. At that Prime Minister, Nehru was not only Prime Minister, also Foreign Minister. That means Nehru is preventing any investigation into that wealth in Tokyo. When a person in the post of a Foreign Minister or Prime Minister of a country prevents such investigation, if he had nothing to hide, or not personally benefited person, and in which capacity IR, being a government officer under the Bombay state government, how could he go without being processed through the formalities, go to Tokyo? Who was his godfather? Who could encourage him, give him that right to go to Tokyo from Bombay? How the papers were cleared. And actually Nehru was the godfather. He was sent by Nehru for some specific purpose. And specific purpose was to manage the plaintiff's story, to build up properly the plaintiff story, and to divide the loot among the looters of that INA treasure. And from this document, you will be clear that the INA wealth, which was in the hands of the Ramamurthy brothers, in the documents clearly showing the wealth has been liquidated gold, and they have purchased properties in Japan, different parts. Also, some wealth has gone outside to UK and USA. And Ramamurthy brothers want to leave Japan and to settle in UK or USA, preferably UK. And here, another person is involved. He is the British intelligence officer. figis who became subsequently Sir Figgis. He was honored by the government of UK as Sir Figgis. Remember, this Figgis who managed the second medical officer, that is Dr. EC, to write a second death certificate for Subhash Chandra Bose. Second death certificate is that person, Figgis. This is in the Figgis file. And actually, the INA wealth main beneficiaries are there, Ramamurthys, Figgis, and this Iyer, and through Iyer, some interest is there of Mr. Nehru. Otherwise, why Mr. Nehru is preventing an investigation into this INA wealth of the Tokyo? When our foreign mission in Tokyo is interested about an investigation into our INA wealth of Tokyo. Because there are, in those files, there are many paper cuttings of Tokyo that the INA wealth has been looted by these Ramamurthys. Another file is there. Not only of Rangoon, in Burma, in different parts, there are multiple INA banks. Those wells has been mentioned in different papers. And the trailing of this wealth, we do not know. Even in Singapore, there was wealth. Thailand, there was wealth. Indochina, there was wealth. These we mentioned in our affidavits in the Calcutta High Court. And also an important file of Parliament, of our Parliament of 1987, which we picked up and we discussed in our affidavit, that there is a mention of 114 crores rupees, which has come from the government of Burma, government of Singapore, and government of Tokyo to Delhi. Our point was, where the money has gone? In the file, it is clearly seen the correspondence between our finance ministry, Reserve Bank, and also the PMO. PMO, Finance Ministry, Reserve Bank correspondence about this 114 crores. 114 crores has entered into India. But where it has gone? Why the subsidy? Suddenly the file is silent. Where the money has gone? That was our point. That was our submission to the High Court. And also there is mention on records of the INA. And in these papers, some personal property of Subhash Chandra Bose, which was some gold-made materials, gold swords, emerald Buddha, and some cigarette cases, gold cigarette cases gifted by Hitler. All those personal things are mentioned in those files. And no trace of those things. That's our submission. And ultimately, after 4 years, the bench of the Chief Justice of Calcutta High Court, T.B. Radhakrishnan and Justice Orijit Banerjee, has given their verdict. Yes, the verdict is not clearly worded. Verdict is not that strong. The verdict in a passive mode, not a clear hard directions, but at least that is something legal in this country. I tell you one thing, among all the historians all over the country, only one person I have seen who has gone through the INA papers in archives and on this INA treasure loot. That is one person, so far I am seeing, he is Professor Kapil Kumar, and no one else. That's the tragedy of this country. And only one parliamentary I have seen last 70 years, and after my becoming politically a bit conscious, after 70s, only Subramaniam Swamy. And anyway, from the legal forum, from a court process, at least I tell you, this verdict is something, a direction to our government in Delhi to open up this chapter. This is a direction to the government of India to see into this issue. Let me read some of the lines. First, first we started, we are the six petitioners. By this time, two has died. One is Jagatjit Dasgupta and his brother Surajit Dasgupta has died. And only four persons we are living. Let the country proceed then. Second sentence I am quoting, with the materials on record, and the lucky point is, whatever archival documents we submitted in our affidavit and supplementary affidavits, fortunately the government of India, when they responded to our appeals, they gave about 200 pages, plenty of archival materials. Actually, government nowhere challenged our documents. Initially, 4 years back, they tried to challenge us. But in subsequent their epidemics, they actually accepted what we have submitted are the materials of the archives. They agreed to the fact that there are really, this question is unanswered, and there are materials, there are documents. And after that submission by the government of India, there are now those all the departments of our government, finance ministry, PMO, home ministry, they are the respondents. We are the petitioners. And now the direction is like this. Let me quote. With the materials on record, by this time, we notice that the assertions of the petitioners is that the movables referred to in the writ petition and other assets of the Indian National Army are not controlled and utilized by the Union of India on behalf of the sovereign nation. That's the observation. The whatever property of the INA has not been taken over by these India. That's their observation. That was also our submission. Whatever has come to this country in a private way, in a dark way, from behind the curtain, just entered into the personal pockets. Yes, the premise appears to be that the assets of the Indian National Army are those which are to be available to the sovereign, that is, we the people of India. The different materials in the form of documents presented by the respondents tend to indicate that there were certain correspondence exchanged between different persons and authorities, which you pointed out. There are correspondence between our Tokyo mission and here our foreign office, also mentioning our then Prime Minister, they are in those files. Also, the correspondence of Nehru in 1946, and they are in Singapore, the correspondences. They are accepting these correspondences. Remember, in 51, when Nehru is telling that we are hesitant to accept the INA property as our government of India property, 1951, regarding Tokyo property. Why Nehru accepted in 1946 6 kg gold from Singapore in his personal account in overseas bank? If you are hesitant to accept it as the property of the government of India, then which logic gave you clearance to accept that 6 kg gold in 1946 in your personal account? If you are hesitant really to regard the INA property as the property of the government of India after division. And why again in 54 you are so eager, 53, 50, you are so eager to clear the issue of INA property of Tokyo by directing our mission in Tokyo to accept whatever property in the hands of the Ramamurthy brothers and give him the certificate that the Ramamurthy are honest? What happened? Actually, what happened? After the loot is complete, only a residual portion is left there. By directing the embassy, taking that residual one from the Ramamurthy brothers and keeping in our foreign office in Tokyo, they whitewashed the face of these Ramamurthys. And indirectly whitewashed the face of Nehru himself. The grand official cover-up. We see that some of them related to the personal properties of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. And yes, they are telling that there are some materials which are the personal property of Subhash Chandra Bose. Then the order is telling for one thing whether or not the personal property of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose could be treated as the property of the Indian National Army. That's a question. Which an entity that no more exists cannot be decided in this writ petition. By that, as it may, even if the law of the is applied to enable India to treat the property including movables referred to in the writ petition as accountable to the Indian Treasury, we can definitely foresee that there is a likelihood of the claims of disputes that may apparently be raised on behalf of the estate of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. That is a separate. About the personal property of Subhash Chandra Bose, now the estate of Netaji Subhash Chandra can put some claims. Okay. Clear. The property of two. And one is the of the INA, other is the of the personal property of Subhash Chandra Bose. Where the estate of Netaji Subhash Chandra, his family can claim. That's the language. The question as to whether the movable properties belonging to Indian National Army could be treated as treasures in favor of the India government, Union of India, is a different matter that has to be deliberated upon only by the government. Let the government decide whether INA property is the property of this government of India. Let the government decide. That is the direction. And not by the court. It is not, the court will not take a decision on this issue. Government of India has to take a decision. In the fitness of the thing, we are of the view that it would be appropriate that the issue raised by the petitioners gain attention even on the basis of the material furnished by the petitioners as well as the materials placed on record by the fourth respondent along with the counter affidavit filed by the competent authority. We therefore direct the respondent 1, 2, 3, both all of the government departments, to take a collective look in such a manner as they may deem fit at the entire issue, which may be relevant for the government to consider and to conclude finally as to what, if any, the government proposes to do regarding the matters relating to issues raised by the petitioners. We therefore order this writ petition directing the respondent 1, 2, 3, three departments of the Government of India to carry out the above said exercise if necessary by calling for further information from any of the officers of the Government of India or other institutions or establishment of the governance as may be relevant, and also providing the petitioners opportunity to place further materials before the Government of India if they wish to do so. We are sure that this exercise will definitely be time consuming. However, we expect the respondent 1, 2, 3, three departments of the Government of India, and thereupon the Government of India, to take a final decision in this matter within the outer limit of 1 year from the date of communication of this order. This is the verdict. Anyway, a legal process is started. After this, the silence of the people of this country. And really speaking, I am very sorry to tell you, some of the friends are telling me some articles has come, scholarly writing, some newspaper article, some Emily Senkel Bose came to Calcutta and went to Boshbadi. These are the stories that are being sold in our market. And some story is being sold maximum now. The story is like that. The film is like that. The volumes is like that. Yet the quality of research in our country, that Bose secretly entered India and led a secret life, a very miserable, poor life, living in poverty, and only to become mad, and then to die in a very miserable way, and his disciples to cover up that story, to save his dignity, as because the man in secrecy, living in such a way that it was disgraceful to him. Therefore, they secretly cremated the person in Guptar Ghat to save his dignity. Yet the stories are being sold and the films are being made. That's the level of our research. If they have concluded that was the fate of Subhash Bose in secrecy, my brothers, where you are demanding files from the Government of India? How nonsense you are! Are you stupids, or you want to think that the country is stupid? When you are telling that he has died in that poverty, in that miserable way, then why you are demanding files from the Government of India? Story writing is one thing. Honest research is a different thing. And love for the country, love for this great man, is absolutely different thing. I know, maybe we'll not be able to regain our lost treasure, DNA treasure, but at least to write the history correctly, we must write who are the looters of this INA treasure and how those looters, the scoundrels, lumpens, has ruled our country for last 70 years. That is my appeal to my countrymen, to my friends, to have a good fight, because the next phase of the fight is there. Utpal, Shankar, Kumar Bose, Rita Banerjee, Rita Dee, Konkona, please think on it. If you lose this INA property is your property. If you cannot save this, at least you, if you can fail to write a proper history of that, where we are, who we are, where is our love for INA, where is our love for the history of INA, heritage of the INA, why you salute the INA soldiers, why we so-called worship for this Netaji. We are all false persons. We are only showing us ourselves, exhibiting ourselves. We are not sincere. We are not honest. Honest fight is different thing. Let me stop here, my friends. Very sorry. Very sorry.